About a week ago, IBM released their new Osprey processor. This is like a new 433 qubit quantum chip. If you haven't checked out our video yet, then what you'll see is that there hasn't really been that much in terms of the actual details of this processor. But actually, several days after we did this video, IBM came out with this new quantum state of the union address, and they had a few more details on the kind of processor and the other further developments. So what we're going to do today is a bit more of an update on the actual processor that they have, see if this video actually sheds a little bit more light and any other details that
we have all 433 qubits arranged in our heavy hex lattice topology. And yes, it's alive and being tested as we speak. Here's a connectivity map of this Osprey and a histogram of our coherence times.
Okay, so this is some actual new data that we didn't have in the last video. But if you actually have a look at this, pretty much in line with what we said previously, which is that the Osprey has basically the same kind of coherence times as the previous Eagle processor. So the median here is 73 microseconds. That's basically the same as what we saw in the Eagle. This type of so-called heavy hex topology, I think is also, in fact, the same as the Eagle, wasn't it?
Yeah. I want to shift gears and talk about that second element of performance, quality. We improved the coherence of Falcon when we went from our R5 revision to R8 by a factor of 3. And we quickly were able to take that learning and feed it into a new revision of Eagle and engineer a new Eagle R3 with three times those T1s as well from our original first generation. Already have a new revision of Osprey, and this is just coming right off the experimental pipeline here where we're seeing a significant coherence time improvements even on a subset of these qubits that we've started to measure on this second generation Osprey device.
Basically what they're saying is that, yeah, they're going to improve it, you know, coherence times very quickly, and look, it's you know, coming up to like more like 300 microseconds rather than the 70 that we were seeing in the initial data. And so this small picture that they have here, I guess this looks like, you know, so they looked at just some small array of the qubits here. And then so each one of these ones are being characterized. So each one's got a T1 and T2 if you look carefully. EPG, what would that be? I don't know. You didn't define it, but yeah. Great. Okay, if you know in the comments, let us know.
Yeah. Now, this all comes together in that we actually need to have performance measured via quantum volume. And last year, we introduced a new tunable coupling architecture that's been described in these research papers that allow us to push our Falcon revision 10 devices to 10 to the negative 3 error rates for 2-qubit gates.
The main message that he's pushing here is that, you know, qubits are going to improve a lot and so forth. But one point in the previous video that we didn't really spell out is that, yes, this thing has like 433 qubits, but a quantum volume of 512, if you translate that, what that really means is that it can do like a 9-qubit circuit. Basically, you've got a 433 qubit machine, but it can only really do nine qubits properly. Once you sort of realize that, and then you get past the jargon of, you know, quantum volume, you know, it looks like it's going up exponentially. But I mean, actually, quantum volume is defined exponentially. It's 2 to the power of some metric, right? It's a largest number of qubits that it can do, right? 2 to the power of 9 is 512. So actually, you know, it's a pretty small scale system that you can really reliably do, right? Kind of
in terms of efficiency.
Shocking, yeah. In a way.
Now, with Falcon R10, we were able to actually double our quantum volume, not once, but twice this past year. First at 256, and then again at 512.
Yeah, so one thing I didn't also quite realize in our last video is that the 512 quantum volume is not the Osprey. Again, it's the Falcon, right?
Falcon.
Yeah, it's again the Falcon. So they kind of upgraded a lot of the things. So the only real performance gain has been actually in the Falcon. Because if you remember the clops, right, that was also on the Falcon. And then so the Osprey actually, you know, the only thing that's sort of better than any other processor is really the number of qubits.
Yeah.
Now, finally, let's talk about that third element, speed. Now, we set ourselves a really challenging goal this year to go from 1.4 thousand clops to 10,000 clops by the end of 2022. And I'm proud to announce that not only have we hit our mark of 10,000 clops, but we've surpassed it. at 15,000 clocks.
I just want to get this. So yes. Everything he had just said now is about Eagle. The only thing he just
Falcon. Mentioned. Yeah, Falcon. Yeah.
Falcon. So mm-hmm. Falcon. Where is Falcon? The very first one. First
yeah, 27 qubit machine. Yeah. So you look sad.
yeah. It's just 27 qubits, and they're able to use only 9 out of the 27, right? Effectively. Yeah. What is Hummingbird and Eagle and Osprey doing actually?
They're being bigger.
Being bigger on the size, yeah.
But all the of them, quantum volume of 9.
Well, probably less than 9, right? Because the Falcon has been improved. That's how they got their performance increase. It was 128 before.
Yeah.
So I guess that's, 7?
7, yes.
7, right? Yeah, 7 qubits.
Yeah.
Oh. Oof.
We have a lot of big problems. We have to solve climate change. We have to work out how we're going to continue to feed the growing population. We need to counter emergent diseases. And we need to work out how we're going to solve and manage our volatile economies.
What really got
yeah, you were going into a huge rant before the video.
yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, the hype is really too much about solving the world food problem.
How's quantum computing going to solve the food problem in the world?
In the world. I don't really understand it. There are so many things that go into food distribution, production of food that is even beyond computing, actually. Maybe solving climate change, fine.
Really?
No, maybe. I said maybe. Maybe. Yes. Discovery of new drugs, fine. Big data management, fine. But is quantum computing or whatever going to the farm to farm and harvest the food, distribute it? What is it really going to do? No, honestly speaking, what is it really going to do?
The only thing I can really think of is basically quantum chemistry, right? Quantum chemistry for everything. So quantum chemistry, making better fertilizers or, you know, better genetic engineering. I don't think that's the problem, is it?
I don't think so either. I don't know. But
even general optimization problems, I mean, quantum computers, I don't think can really always get a speed up. In fact, so we have some recent review article, if anybody interested. It's on so-called Ising machines. And basically, you know, we reviewed basically whether such machines can actually get a speed up. And, you know, sadly, actually, it's very rare to actually get a speed up. So even with these optimization problems, it's pretty tenuous, to be honest. But, okay, anyway, this is not the main point of the video, so let's keep going.
2023 marks the point where everything changes. It's actually what we think of as the next wave in quantum computing. Today, we build single processors. But we realize the path ahead is multiple processors. In the future, we need scalable controls.
And this is, I think, what I was saying in the previous video, that you know, they seem to be going towards this network approach, which, you know, it sounds like it's good, but I mean, you know, in a quantum sense, I mean, what you really need are 2-qubit gates, entangling gates, and then, so, you know, can you really do that across processors efficiently? I mean, if you can't even do it that well, even on a single processor, then, you know, if you're interconnecting different chips, I kind of seriously doubt that, you know, this is really going to be a single quantum machine. You know, it's really more like you just got a bunch of different smaller quantum machines.
And in the combination process, what will be the process like, if how we can interconnect two chips?
Well, yeah. So I think what you're asking is, do these chips really, they're like a quantum network, you know, is it able to communicate quantum mechanically between them?
I
imagine it's actually very, very limited, if anything, right?
I think so too, right now. Let me just ask a question. With one processor, what are we able to do with one processor right now? You know, connecting all the things, what exactly?
Well, yeah, not much. I don't know. I think you're baiting me into saying that. Not really that much, if that's what you're trying to get me to say. Yes.
Okay. So then, back to what you are saying. So if it's not much, then does connecting 2, 3, 4, 5 help us?
In the sense that there's like some classical parallelism, right? So say, for example, you know, maybe this is the situation. Let's say you're doing your some kind of variational quantum circuit again, because I think this is sort of what they have in mind. Then maybe you could basically do just multiple runs of this, like all kind of at the same time, because you've got like multiple quantum processes. And then so you can just have that classical parallelism, right? But then actually what you really want, I mean, if you really want a genuine large-scale quantum computer, is one big quantum processor. These are, like, as you pointed out, like pretty small, right?
Yeah.
Or still small, and then you're joining together quite small systems. Well, I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know, man.
What we are calling quantum-centric supercomputing. To me, a quantum-centric supercomputer is a modular computing architecture which will enable scaling. It will use communication to increase the computational capacity.
So communication, quantum communication or classical communication? Doesn't say, does it?
So here we're considering a machine learning algorithm, which we call quantum kernels, and combining it with the circuit knitting toolbox I talked about earlier. First, we need to define the circuit and set up the clouds, the multi-cloud environment to run on. Then the quantum serverless tools will handle all the orchestration for you. Next, we compile the higher level circuits and map them to the physical circuits. And the circuit knitting I described earlier before using the circuit cutting method decomposes this into four smaller circuits.
I think this might answer your question a little bit about what do you do with smaller quantum processors, because I think they're decomposing circuits into smaller ones, right? But I guess that would require them to be maybe not one giant quantum system, like it would have to be sort of separate.
Thanks to the serverless and Qiskit runtime, these subcircuits can be sent in parallel. They're executed using the primitives. Error mitigation and suppression, as Blake talked about, are applied, and the results are sent back to Qiskit runtime as a service. Then these reliable results can be combined in any other cloud for the final answer. And just like that, sent to the user. Here's the code, and you can see how it distributes work over three different clouds.
Let's see, what does it say here? Okay, IBM Q Kolkata, Auckland. So these would be two different machines, right?
Yeah.
I think the idea is to sort of, you know, cut the circuit and dispatch it to different.
If you look here, that Azure, I think, is a cloud.
Okay, so Azure is their cloud computing architecture. So I think this is
not quantum again.
This is not a quantum thing at all.
It's just storing purpose.
Yes.
So earlier, Blake showed you this plot. And he showed you how error mitigation can enable better results. And he also told you that we wanted to simulate these circuits at a lower cost than classical computing. But we're issuing a challenge to all of you. We're calling it the 100 by 100 challenge. And we're pledging that in 2024, we'll offer our partners and clients and all of you a system that will generate reliable outcomes running 100 qubits and a gate depth of 100.
That's an enormous jump, right? From 9.
The circuit depth to 100.
9 to 100. By 2024, I honestly don't know what the catch is. Like a lot of the other things, I can kind of see like what the catch is, because, you know, okay, you just increase the number of qubits. All right, okay, you just do that. You just go and print a bunch of qubits, right? And then you hit your benchmark, right? Or if you interlink a bunch of quantum processors, you know, that's largely a classical kind of job, you know, and clearly they've already got a bunch of processors. They can do that. But then if you're saying 100 by 100, you know, and they're doing 9. I mean, I just don't know. I don't know how they're going to hit this.
They combine 9 circuit tests together 3 times.
Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking. That's what I'm thinking as well.
Yeah.
You know, they're going with this idea of making, you know, combining processors.
Yeah.
So if one processor can handle 9.
So yeah.
So 9 by 9 is about 81, right?
Oh, so they just get 9 of it? No. I mean, really? No. I mean, if
I don't know.
If you look at the brief, I mean, let's read the brief here, right? Estimating noise field circuits consisting of 100 qubits, depth 100 within a day. This on the surface sounds like quantum volume, right? Because quantum volume is like some number of qubits and some depth, right?
Yeah.
So if they were to say that, right, what's 2 to the power of 100? So that would mean a quantum volume of 1.26 times 10 to the 30. So it can't be quantum volume because, you know, they're doing like 128, you know, 256, 512 this year. And then they're saying 2024, if this is quantum volume, then it would be, you know, 512, no, 1.26 times 10 to the 30, right? So it can't be quantum volume. So, you know, this is why I think there has to be some catch here. And maybe the catch is the way that they're phrasing this. So maybe it's like what you said, that it's 100 by 100, but then, actually, you know, they split up the circuit, 100 qubit circuit into, you know, 10 smaller ones.
Yeah.
Because if you see their roadmap, I think it is after they're combining, they are estimating larger.
Yeah.
Because up to now, it is only one chip or one processor from Falcon to
Exactly.
But in the next stage, they say that they will combine it.
It will not be modular things.
You know? Combining, yeah. So that's why they estimate maybe this thing, which is challenging.
My goodness.
Why are we so confident that we can release hardware like this? I hope most of this morning illuminate our excitement in the direction that we're going. We've showed you the power of our error mitigation techniques.
Okay, so let's have a look at this graph. Error on the horizontal axis, circuit sampling overhead.
What do they mean by circuit sampling?
Well, maybe it's got to do with error mitigation. The worse your qubits are, right?
Yeah.
The more samples that you need to do to overcome your errors, right? So in error mitigation, what you do is you repeat your circuit a lot of times so that you can overcome your noisy qubits by post-processing. You know, if your circuits are clean, then basically you can afford to run your circuit once or a small number of times, and then, you know, you get your answer. But then if your qubits are dirty, you know, noisy, then you got to run it a lot of times to compensate for that fact. So this graph must be something like an error mitigation scheme where, you know, you can overcome the errors by sampling a lot, right? So this is why these curves kind of go up as your errors increase. Right? Yeah, they have some time limit as well, right? So they said, you know, you can run 100 qubit by 100 depth circuit within
one day.
Okay, so here it says 1 day. Yeah, so they must have some kind of scheme in mind when they're calculating this. Yeah, I mean, it just doesn't sound like a fully quantum calculation, right? So, you know, who knows what this estimate is actually based on. So, well, what do you guys think?
Yeah, I think they have provided a roadmap, but again, whether we can classify it as completely quantum or not, that is still, not clear, because sometimes, like, those parallel programming they are doing, like storing the results on clouds, that simulation part is, of course, done by that quantum-like part. They have simulators, but storing on it is not, I think, defined, or like whether it is clouds, what clouds are they?
I think the clouds are classical, right?
Yeah, we have seen. That's what I'm saying.
Clouds are classical, yes.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah,
I think as so. Yes.
But maybe they might develop. But
some quantum in the cloud?
Some quantum
map. Yes, I think that's a great point. I mean, that, you know, really, okay, they're doing this, is all sounds very impressive, but is it kind of really quantum? And, you know, this was basically the questions that D-Wave had to face. So, you know, D-Wave, the academic community, was pretty unkind to them. In fact, actually, later on, I think the opinion of a lot of people changed and said that, actually, you know, they really got some decent hardware, but, you know, actually nobody has a really good quantum computer anywhere in the world. So in hindsight, actually, they were sort of pioneers in a way of this kind of commercial path. I think it's only fair that IBM kind of faces that same music, right? You know, I mean, they got to really show that everything that they're doing is fully quantum and not just a whole bunch of smaller quantum machines that are just all next to each other. Okay. All right. Should we leave it there?
Yeah.
All right. So. Okay. Thanks for watching, and see you for the next episode.
Yeah. Bye. Bye-bye.